Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Oh, oh, oh. Everybody praise him here. Everything belongs to you. Tell him, thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. We got one more round to go. Come on, everybody. Hey,
just wanna praise you.
Everybody praise him here. Ever and ever, Lord, yes. Give it to him here. Blessings, honor, and glory.
Blessings and honor.
And glory.
And glory.
They all belong.
They all belong to
blessings
you.
And honor. Hey.
Blessings and honor.
And glory.
And glory.
They all belong.
They all belong to you.
Blessings and honor. Glory to God.
This is FBCG News, a summary of news and events occurring on our church calendar. The Dorcas Ministry is hosting our annual Season Citizens Banquet on Sunday, September 12th from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. at the LaFontaine Blue located in New Carrollton, Maryland. We encourage you to show a seasoned citizen that you care by supporting this event. Buy a ticket and sponsor or bring a senior citizen to the banquet. Tickets are available for purchase before and after service at the Dorcas Ministry table in the lobby.
The Prince George's County political landscape will undergo significant change during the upcoming fall elections. A number of crucial elective positions impacting the viability of our county will be decided when you cast your ballot. That's why First Baptist is hosting a political candidates forum this Friday, September 3rd at 7:30 p.m. at the Ministry Center, so you can hear the candidates present their views on topical issues.
Early registration ends today for the Turning Point Ministry Fall Session. This ministry offers Christ-centered small group training that assists people in dealing with life-controlling problems, as well as those who are in any level of a relationship with a person with a life-controlling problem. Those problems can be in any and all areas, such as substance abuse, anger, addictions, and more. Turning Point has separate classes for adults and youth ages 13 to 17.
Our First Baptist Women's Ministry will resume its teachings on the disciplines of godly women this Saturday, September 4th at 8:15 a.m. at the Ministry Center. There will also be breakout sessions covering the 10 different disciplines of godly women. Immediately following our breakout sessions, please join us for our Sisters Cafe, where you can drop in and meet the leaders of our Women Developing Women's Group and find a ministry specifically designed for you. Take some time to meet new sisters and catch up with other sisters you may already know.
Singles, is your money funny? Are you living from paycheck to paycheck? Are you financially ready for marriage? For answers to these questions and more, come to the Singles Ministry Fellowship this Saturday, September 4th at 7 p.m. at the Ministry Center for an evening of fun, fellowship, and finances. Our guest speaker is Ernest Burley, an author, certified financial planner, and chartered financial consultant who will help you explore ways to become a better steward of your money.
Tuesday, September 7th at 7 p.m. at the Worship Center. The Education Ministry hosts our annual Back to School Prayer Night, where we gather to pray collectively for students, parents, guardians, educators, support personnel, and all who are involved with educating children. Start the new year off on the right foot in the presence of God.
That does it for this week's edition of FBCG News. Please register in the lobby before and after each service for all events mentioned today. For complete details about all First Baptist events, please visit our church website at fbcglenarden.org. First Baptist Church of Glenarden, where God is developing dynamic disciples.
Amen. We have one additional announcement. We request the prayers and support of the church family for the passing of one of our members, Vashti Green. The homegoing celebration will be held on Thursday, September 2nd. The viewing will start at 10 a.m., followed by the service at 11 a.m. Let's keep that family in our prayers. It's now time to worship the Lord through the giving of our tithes and offerings.
Yes, I thought you.
As always, First Baptist, thank you for being such incredible givers. Our church is able to make impact all throughout this world because of the faithful giving of our members. And we just want to say thank you for being obedient givers to God. If you're looking for an envelope, it should be one in this seat back pocket in front of you. If not, one of our ushers will be glad to serve you if you just raise your hand. If you're making a check, you should always make that to FBCG. If we're prepared already to give, let's go ahead and pray for our gifts. Lord, thank you so much for the privilege of giving back to you a portion of what you have given us, Lord. We thank you and we know, God, that we just cannot beat you giving. So we thank you again for this privilege, this opportunity to sow into this church and give to you, Lord. We thank you for fertile ground to sow into. We pray that you would take these, our gifts, receive them, God, as pleasing in your sight, Lord. Take them, bless them, break them, and distribute them throughout this world, God, as you see fit, for your glory and for the advancement of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh!
Yeah.
now time for the word. Amen. All right. Today our guest preacher is Dr. Richard Allen Farmer. Amen. Let's turn our attention to the IMAX.
Dr. Richard Allen Farmer is a former pastor and college chaplain who spends most of his time offering inspirational, informational, and musical presentations that clearly demonstrate his passion and excellence for these endeavors. Dr. Farmer was born and raised in New York City, where he began piano studies at the age of 11 and became a person of faith at age 12. As his faith and musicianship grew, they were blended. Dr. Farmer now uses his music as a vehicle for inspiring, motivating, challenging, and entertaining diverse audiences around the world. Dr. Richard Allen Farmer is a graduate of Nyack College, where he earned a Bachelor of Music degree in 1975, and Princeton Theological Seminary, where he earned his Master of Divinity degree in 1980. Dr. Farmer has also been awarded an Honorary Doctorate of Divinity degree by Gordon College in 1986 and the Honorary Doctor of Sacred Theology degree by Houghton College in 1999. Dr. Farmer has served as senior pastor of the Bethany Baptist Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and is dean of the chapel at both Gordon College and Taylor University. Very much committed to being a global person, Dr. Farmer has spoken, lectured, or given concerts in England, throughout Asia, Africa, Central and South America, the Philippines, Canada, and most states of the United States. Dr. Richard Allen Farmer is an avid animal lover. He's also a certified scuba diver, motorcyclist, Segway rider, and an instrument-rated pilot. He resides in Dallas, Texas with his wife, Rosemary, and their son.
Why don't we stand and give a First Baptist welcome to Dr. Richard Allen Farmer.
Bless you, beloved. Bless you. The scripture lesson which I'm going to explore has already been read in your hearing from Mark's Gospel, chapter 14. I simply want to invite you to pray with me as we turn to that passage again. We thank you, Papa God, that you speak in so many ways to us. Thank you for the way you arrest us through music. Thank you for the power of the spoken word. Grant that as we gather round it, you might use this mere mortal to articulate immortal truths. We thank you that you love us enough to grant to us your word, to give us access to it in so many versions. We thank you for print media, for the Bible on CDs, on DVD. We thank you for access to it in so many versions. Grant that your word may find a home in our hearts. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. And God's people said, amen. Please be seated. At the end of our service this morning, it'll be my joy to meet you at a product table out in the gathering area. There are four items on that table. Each of them is $20. One is called A Taste of Home, songs I remember singing as I was growing up. Another is an album that contains both a CD and a DVD of a sermon I preached here about a year ago from the Book of Ruth called Redefining Empty. This is a series of five CDs, audio sermons called Getting High, Memorable Mountaintop Moments. This is five sermons on five different mountains in the Bible and what happened on that mountain. And then a sermon called Sulking in the Sunlight. Again, this one album has both the CD and the DVD in it. This is one of my favorite sermons to preach. You remember in the book of Jonah, Jonah went and preached in Nineveh, and he should have been ecstatic because the whole city repented. And he should have been excited. But he went outside the city of Nineveh and said to God, just kill me now. Let me die. I would rather die than have those people be my spiritual equals. And he was such a racist that he said to God, instead of celebrating, I'd rather just sit here and sulk. And Lord, I would be honored if you just take away my life. Just kill me now. I'd rather you kill me than for me to have to deal with these Ninevites in their current spiritual state. Because now I got to treat them as fellow heirs. And it's an indictment upon us all if we ever get to that point where we're sulking rather than celebrating another's spiritual life. So I'll be back there giving out Texas-sized hugs and signing your albums if you'd like, and just simply greeting you. So please come back there and say hello. That's where I'll be at the end of our service. This text in Mark 14, verses 1 to 9, fascinate me. I'm calling this sermon Breaking the Jar. And all day today, I'm going to be preaching from the Gospel of Mark, different passages in each service. I'll be preaching four different messages all day today. A great honor to be here with you again today and in this pulpit that is normally occupied by my dear friend and brother, John Kenneth Jenkins, Sr. In this text, Mark 14, verses 1 to 9, we find Jesus at the home of Simon the leper. I don't know how long he's been healed of leprosy. He's already cured. But I do note, and I won't pause long on this point, but I do note that Jesus is never ashamed to go to houses that we wouldn't go to. Some folks wouldn't care how long Simon had been a leper. The fact that he was a leper ever would mean we would never go to his house. I don't trust that former leprosy stuff. I'm not going to his house. Well, I might still catch it. I'm not going there at all, some of us would say. I love the fact that Jesus went to the houses of people that many of us wouldn't visit. In fact, one of the problems with the Jewish leaders, the problems that they had with Jesus, was that he seemed to gravitate toward these adulterers and prostitutes and gluttons and wine bibbers, and he seemed to be attracted to those kind of people that needed help. He was almost like a doctor, and he was attracted to the sick. And the Jewish leaders just couldn't understand that. They couldn't get with him on that. So I note here with great delight that Jesus is at the home of a man who was a leper. Now, we could accuse Jesus of extravagance here. That is, he is spending valuable time just kicking it, hanging out, chilling. He's on his way to Calvary. And many of us would say this is an extraordinary waste of time. When you're on your way to death, you ought to be making better use of your hours than sitting around at the home of a leper just cooling it. The beginning of this chapter says that the chief priests and the teachers of the law were plotting to kill Jesus. Surely he can do something better with his time than socialize with Simon. Speaking of extravagance, what about this unnamed woman? John says it was Mary in John's version of this story in John chapter 12. He says it was Mary. Mark just simply says a woman. But if Jesus is extravagant in his use of these last hours of his life, you could accuse this woman of extravagance. She comes into the room and proceeds to break open a very expensive jar of perfume and pour the whole thing on Jesus' head. If Jesus could have used his time better, this woman could have used this perfume better. She could have used it in a more responsible way. In fact, the critics say as much in verses 4 to 5. They say that this money could have been given to the poor, or she's really wasting a lot of it. If you want to demonstrate to Jesus that you love him, you could pour a few drops on his head and let that be enough. That's a statement. You don't have to pour the whole thing out. And Jesus defends her waste by uttering two truths. I just want to unpack those two truths. Verse 6 of Mark 14. Leave her alone, said Jesus. Why are you bothering her? Here's the line that I find fascinating. She has done a beautiful thing to me, says the New International Version. I had not thought about that until I started working on this passage, and I'm enjoying reading the Word of God more slowly these days. I appreciate Through the Bible in a Year reading programs, but sometimes you read so quickly you miss the nuggets. Some of these one-liners are pregnant with possibilities. Here's the line: "She has done a beautiful thing to me." I had not ever thought before I started working on this sermon of worship as something that one does to Jesus. We think of worship as something we offer to Jesus, or we think of worship as something we do for God. We're going to give him some praise. But listen to this. Worship is partly something that one does to Jesus. One does not merely say words or sing songs or recite creeds or give offerings or head up ministries and programs. Worship also has to do with the breaking of that which is valuable to me, and I, quote, waste it all on Jesus. I pour it all out on this one, and I do not think it's extravagant. It is what I do to him. Now, probably, and I wasn't there, and the text doesn't give me permission to make a big deal of this, but in this culture, you would not simply pour the oil on the person whom you were anointing. If she was pouring it on Jesus' head, she probably then rubbed the oil into his scalp, played with his hair. She didn't just pour it on and say, "That's my worship." She got into it. She poured it on his head and then probably rubbed it in and massaged it. And one version says, in fact, she then wiped his feet with her hair. She engaged the Christ and got all up close to him. Worship is not this distant deity approach where we simply say a few things to God at a safe distance. It's massaging his scalp, and it's getting all in there. It is breaking open the jar and then staying there and doing something to Jesus. This is the graduate level of worship. It is developing that kind of intimacy that dares one to take on the Christ and be up close. When I grow up, I want to worship like this woman did. She did not simply do something in front of Jesus. She did something to Jesus. She poured out, according to this text, nard. Nard was a very expensive perfume made up of two plants, from nodula and spike. In fact, some places it's called spikenard. You may have seen that word in Bible studies. According to verse 5, the perfume was worth more than a year's wages. Imagine that. Think of whatever you make a year. And then think of taking a dollar amount of that much perfume or ointment, and taking the entire amount, a year's worth of your salary, and pouring the whole thing on Jesus' head. I don't read in this text where she said, "I gotta save a little for myself, because I gotta get through the rest of the year. Let me drop a few drops on Jesus, maybe enough to represent a tithe, and then I need to sell the rest because mama got things to do." In fact, some of the critics said, you know, we could have taken some of that oil and used it to feed the poor. We could have sold it, taken the proceeds and invested it in ministry. And I hear this woman saying, yeah, but worship is a ministry. I want to blow the whole jar on the woman, on Jesus. In fact, some have asked the question, why did she break the jar? Couldn't she just pour the ointment out and at least salvage the jar? I mean, lady, come on. This is extravagant. You're not only wasting the perfume, but now you've wasted the jar. We can't even recycle the container. I want to suggest that if you walk with God long enough, you'll get to the point where it is your highest joy to give away everything you have in the name of worship. The ointment and the jar. In 2007, a mere 5% of adults in churches tithed. The median giving per person in that same year in churches was a little over $1,000 a year. To our shame. You can almost picture us holding the jar back. In 1860, I found this quote fascinating. The Earl of Shaftesbury, an evangelical British minister, spoke at the Liverpool Conference on Missions. And he said, here's the quote, "Those who hold the truth have the means enough, knowledge enough, and opportunity enough to evangelize the globe 50 times over." This was in 1860, 150 years ago. Those who hold the truth have the means enough, knowledge enough, and opportunity enough to evangelize the globe 50 times over. And why is it not getting done? Because we're holding back the jar. Rather than breaking it open. I remember singing in the college choir a setting of Christina Rossetti's poem, which we hear mostly at Christmas time. Her poem, In the Bleak Midwinter, the fifth stanza of which says, "What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what can I give him? Give him my heart." You can picture this woman. What can I give him? I have this jar of perfume. I will spend that on the Christ. That's what I have. And Jesus calls her act of worship a beautiful thing. She has done something beautiful to me. Then Jesus says a second thing about her. He utters a second truth. It's in verse 7, second clause of verse 7. He says, "Leave her alone. She has done a good thing, and you will not always have me with you." You'll not always have me. I love Jesus' answer. Leave her alone. She made a good choice. Don't stop her worship. It is right. She has done a beautiful thing to me. And then he says to them, you ought to take a cue from this woman because you won't always have me. She has seen what is important right now. And those of you who say, well, she could have spent that money on the poor, he said, you'll always have the poor with you. You won't always have me with you. Jesus is on his way to agony, to death. And we must be cautious as we read this text, for Jesus is not implying that the poor are not to be cared for. He's saying the precise opposite. You will always have the poor. You'll always have them in your face. You'll always need to care about them. And you don't need to choose between acts of adoration and acts of service to the poor. You'll do both. It is a both and scenario, not either or. But one must seize the time with Jesus that one has, because you only have a window of opportunity. The authentic worshiper says, I must worship God right now. Her name was Lois. She was a woman in her mid-50s and a member of the congregation I served. She was a divorced woman with two adult sons. Very often when she had something happening in her life, because she was a divorced woman, she would come to the men of our church and just ask us what we thought about different decisions she had to make. One day she came to me, she said, Pastor Farmer, my employer is trying to get rid of some of us who've been on the job a long time, and they're offering us an early out package. What do you think? I said, take the money and run. And then I said this to her. I said, you know how you feel right now. You do not know how you'll feel in 5 years or 7 years. Don't stay in there any longer than you have to. Get out now and enjoy your sons and your grandchildren. And so she did that. Less than 10 years later, Lois had advanced dementia. Didn't even know her sons' names or her grandchildren. She made the right choice. Get out, because you'll always have the poor with you, but you'll not always have this window. This is what Jesus is saying. You don't know about tomorrow, 5 years from now. You know about right now. And this woman did a right thing. She understood that he is on his way to Calvary. He's on his way to death. I must get with Jesus now. There's some of you waiting. You said, you know, in 5 years from now, as soon as I get some stuff straight, I'm going to get real serious about worship. I'm going to praise Jesus, but not now. But I'm getting real close. I'm on the edges. I'm looking. I'm observing. And a lot of you people are praising Jesus. And I'm watching you. And in 5 years, you wait. I'm going to really get it. I'm going to be in a small group. And I'm going to get serious about Bible study. And I'm going to get into prayer. And I'm going to be a person of God. And I'm going to be worshiping. And, oh, you just wait 5 years from now. I just got to retire first. And then I got to get some things straight. Now my children just drive me nuts. But in 5 years, last one to be out, be off to college, and then I'm going to get real serious. And Jesus says, you won't always have me. If you ever were inclined to worship me, you ought to worship me now. If you ever were inclined to give me all you've got and break open your jaw, I'm suggesting you ought to do it right now. There's a wonderful gospel song out there. C.C. Winans sings it, and other artists as well. The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. Then that chorus, and I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me, and you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can hear some critic now. You know, y'all are just over the top in your worship. It don't take all that to praise him. And I want to suggest that we won't always have this time. We won't even always have this mindset. You ought to praise him now while you can. And give him glory now while you can. While I'm able, I'll raise my hand and bless his name. While I'm able, I'll open my mouth and declare his praises. 10 years from now, I might not even know my own name. So while I know his name now, I'll bless his name and declare his name now. You won't always have him with you, but you have him now. Declare it now. Break open your jaw now. Let us praise our master now. Yeah. So sit down. There are bookends on this text. Before the woman broke open her jaw, we read, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. That's in verse 1. And later on in the text, in verse 10, it says, then Judas Iscariot went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. So chief priests trying to figure out a way to kill him. Verse 1. Verse 10, Judas betrays him. And between those horrible bookends is this performance of the extraordinary act of worship. As Jesus poured out his life for many, this woman pours out her life in the adoration of the One. I'm very physical with my son. I have a son who's 17 years old. I love that boy. Oh, I'm in love. I love Timothy. I'm very physical with him. I kiss him a lot. I hug him. I kiss him and hug him every day. I've had people tell me that I should not do that. They tell me that's just over the top, but don't take all that. You know, sure, you can tell him you love him by, you know, putting food on the table and you punch him a few times each day. What up, man? How you doing, dog? I prefer kisses and hugs. And then I tell my friends who tell me to stop kissing all over that boy, you're going to make him effeminate, stop all that. I tell them, listen, I tell them just what Jesus said to these critics, leave me alone. That's what I tell them. I will not always have him with me, and I must seize this window right now. Jesus affirms this woman and says, you have chosen the right time to demonstrate your love for me. This is the right time. I want to call us all to extravagant, lavish, over-the-top worship. Let us pour out our guts in adoration of Jesus. I got to wrap this up. I never use the word adore for human beings. I've been on the planet for 58 years. I've never used the word adore for a person. I never say, I just adore her. I just adore John. I never say that. I say, I love him, I love her. I really admire them, great. They're very special. I just love them to pieces. But I save adoration for Jesus. That's a minor point. Some would say, oh, you know what I mean. I've never said of your child, and never will, and never even of my own baby, she's adorable. I say she's cute. She's not to be adored, however. She's cute, cuddly. I've even said she's got edible cheeks. Let me kiss that little baby. Come here, pumpkin. I just love babies. I love the chomp on their necks right there and the cheeks. And there's a place right there on the thigh. Oh. Just eat up the baby. I love all that. But they're not to be adored. Only Jesus. This woman says, Christ, I adore you. Christ, I bow down before you. Christ, I open the jar and I pour out everything I have on you. I want to get to this point. Two truths. She has done a beautiful thing to me. You will not always have me. And that defines the way worship ought to be done today. I close with a hymn by Robert Grant. You might remember, those of you who are raised in the church, you might remember singing this old, old classic hymn. Oh, worship the King. All glorious above. You remember that? We used to sing it. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might. Oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunderclouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air. It shines in the light. It streams from the hills. It descends from the plains. and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain, frail children of dust, that's you and me, and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end, our maker, defender, redeemer, and friend. And you, don't wait to worship him. He's worthy now. Praise him now. There's some of you here this morning who have been holding so tightly to your alabaster box, you have not ever, with abandon, worshiped Jesus. You've been dripping out little bits of oil, but pretty much holding the jar to yourself. Today, I dare you to break open the jar and give God the praise he deserves. Out loud, over the top, lavish, extravagant, without question. A year's worth of wages, believing that he will supply your every need. My friend, the late E.K. Bailey, said he had a hard time for a long time raising his hands in worship. He said it was just too Pentecostal for him. He was a Baptist pastor in Dallas. He said, I just couldn't raise my hands. He said, then one day it dawned on me if I was being arrested. And the policeman said, put your hands up. He said, I would submit to his authority without question, and I would raise my hand. He said, it dawned on me if I could raise my hands for the cops, I could raise my hands for Jesus. It dawned on me if I could submit to a policeman, I could submit to Jesus. If I could raise my hand for a cop, I could raise my hand for the King of Kings. Hey, I'm done. Worship him.
Oh, bless the Lord. What a message. Let's thank God for the message. Let's thank God for the messenger. You may be here today, and you never made a decision to just raise your hands for Jesus. And you haven't done that because you do not know him. Or you may be here today, and you raise your hands for Jesus at one time, but for whatever reason, the circumstances in your life, you lowered them. Or maybe you've been raising your hands and running from one church to another, looking for a place that you feel comfortable in. As I read God's word, I'm never real comfortable because it cuts like a two-edged sword. Or you may be here today just unsure whether you're saved or whether you're not saved. We want to offer Christ to you today. Surrender to him. You may not have the alabaster box to break today, but you can raise your hands to him today and worship and glorify him. So if you fall in either one of those four categories, would you just come and meet me here at the altar? Unsaved, unsure about your salvation. Backslidden, unchurched. In either one of those areas, would you just come right now? Don't be ashamed. Jesus made a profound statement in his word, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father. Would you come? Would you come this day? Come today and receive Jesus as Lord and Savior within your life. Come, 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 come.
He will give you brand new life. Life abundantly. Oh, just as you are. Come to cry. We offer Christ to you. Offer Christ. He's available. Oh my. We offer Christ. Yes, we do. Oh my sister.
Thank you, Lord.
He will give you brand new life. Yes, he will. Life abundantly.
Life abundantly.
Oh,
just